Hey everybody, Reid here. Welcome to another installment of the Video Power Rankings. Today I'm covering Modern. My opinion, Modern's in a really good place right now. There seems to be a huge diversity of decks that can perform well in a tournament setting. So let's get to the top 15. In 15th place, we have Affinity and Hardened Scales. So if you think about Urza's Saga being one of the best cards in Modern and sort of a pillar of the format, there are a couple of like very popular versions of Urza Saga decks, and Affinity and Hardened Scales would be one of the fringe or less popular versions of Urza Saga, but still a great way to use that card, and frankly a great surrounding shell of powerful cards. The most common build right now, I'd say, is Mono Blue Affinity using Thoughtcast and Thought Monitor. But I'm also partial to Hardened Scales. I wrote a deck guide recently about red-green Hardened Scales, and I find that deck to be just really cool, make for awesome combat steps, tricky games to navigate, and a deck that's, you know, rewards the skill of its pilot. Coming in at number 14, we have Goblin Charbelcher. This is an example of a fast combo deck that's just racing directly towards a quick win. It uses the Zendikar Rising double-faced land spells. And the idea with these cards is that if they're in any zone other than on the battlefield, so if they're in your library, they do not count as lands. That means you activate Goblin Charbelcher, you flip through every single card in your deck, because the deck has no actual, you know, honest old-fashioned lands, and you deal an amount of damage equal to the number of cards in your library, which is going to be way more than lethal. And you can do this as early as like the second turn of the game, very, very often third turn of the game. It's a great combo deck, and against opponents who don't have a lot of disruption, you're going to get easy wins. Coming in at number 13, we have a little bit more of a tried and true strategy. It's Urzatron. Urzatron has been around definitely as long as I can remember, and it's still a great way to sort of go over the top of people. So a lot of folks in this format are doing the mid-range value battles with you know, two-for-one advantages, Omnaths, Expressive Iterations, and if you play Urzatron, you can just go, boom, drop the hammer, turn three Karn Limerated, and just kind of ignore everything your opponent's doing. Number 12 ranked deck today is one of those mid-range value decks. It's Jund. So I would say more often Jund Saga Van, but I've seen more traditional non-Saga versions of Jund do well also. I'm pretty excited about the recent printing of Riveteer's Charm as an answer to Murktide Regent and a bunch of other problematic cards. But yeah, Jund is just, it remains very well-rounded, very customizable, excellent sideboard, so you can gear it to fight any matchup or any metagame that you are worried about. Number 11 is Burn. So Urzatron and Burn, you know, this could be 2022 or it could be 2012. But those decks are still top strategies in Modern. I like them, and Burn in particular, because you don't really have to worry about shifts in the metagame, because you can sort of just do your thing, and your thing happens to be lighting the opponent on fire. Burn is, yeah, a very, not necessarily easy to pilot, but easy to understand direct strategy that I think can be a good entry point to the format. And is going to be, you know, a deck that can be successful in the hands of a pilot of any level of experience. Number 10 is Elementals. So this won't be the only deck on the list that features Omnath, Locus of Creation, but the idea is that you have four or five colors of mana. You have Omnath, you have the pitch elementals, namely Solitude and Fury and Endurance between the main deck and the sideboard. And what really distinguishes the Elemental Tribal deck is Risen Reef. So Risen Reef, you go crazy when you have those ephemerate turns, you know, multi-triggering all of your enters the battlefield abilities. But Risen Reef also just makes it so that every time you use a pitch elemental, you get repaid your investment. So in other words, you exile a white card from your hand, you cast Solitude, you kill their best creature, you get the card right back from the trigger of Risen Reef. And then, as I mentioned, once you get to the point in the game where you're hard casting elementals, where you're ephemerating things, you can just spiral out of control so quickly that Elementals is the nightmare matchup for anyone who's trying to play a fair, value-centric, grindy game. Number 9 is Azorius Control. Another tried and true strategy, another grindy deck, you know, sort of in the same conversation as Jund in terms of this has been around a long time. It's very customizable. It has its diehard fans, has a strong sideboard. So Azorius Control has wavered between being one of the top decks in the format or holding more of a middle position like this. But if you're the type of player who enjoys a good old-fashioned long game with counterspells, Azorius Control can still be the deck for you. Number 8 is Primeval Titan. Sometimes I say Amulet Titan, as that is the best, most popular, most successful version of Primeval Titan. But I actually did see a classic red-green Valakut deck go undefeated in a recent Magic Online preliminary event. So there's more than one way to use a Primeval Titan, put it that way. This is one of the pillars of the format, just racing towards that turn 4, sometimes even turn 3 Titan. It's a very, very clean, direct way to score a win. The lands are so powerful in Modern, namely Valakut, the Molten Pinnacle, that if you do get to cleanly resolve a Primeval Titan, you usually get so much value that you're almost certain to win the game the following turn. Number 7, we have Living End, one of many sort of cascade into a free spell archetype. One of the many decks that fit that bill in Modern. But the idea with Living End is that in addition to your cascade cards and your namesake Living End, the rest of your deck is mostly just cycling creatures. So that means that you have consistency, you increase your access to your key cards, and then when you cast Living End, you simultaneously wipe the opponent's battlefield and return all those cycling creatures to your side of the battlefield. So very consistent way to create an overwhelming advantage very early in the game. Living End is just a great deck. Number 6, we have Yawgmoth, Golgari Yawgmoth. This has been my deck of choice over the last few months. It's very resilient creature deck, creature-based combo deck, where the idea, usually the way the games play out, is that you'll develop your mana in the early game, put a bunch of creatures on the battlefield, some of them maybe have Undying, and then in the mid game you either cast Yawgmoth Thran Physician or you find it via Eldritch Evolution or Court of Calling. From there, you get to decimate the opponent's battlefield, draw a ton of cards, use these Undying creatures for multiple shots at sacrificing and drawing cards, and then eventually you assemble Yawgmoth with two Undying creatures, where sacrificing each one can remove or negate the counter on the other, and you can loop them, drawing an unbounded number of cards, eventually find Blood Artist, and one-shot the opponent. So that was a long-winded way of saying that the Yawgmoth deck can generate tons of value and card advantage on its way towards working to an infinite combo that one-shots the opponent. Number 5, we have Death Shadow, and I have to say this is the biggest winner for this installment of the Power Rankings. Death Shadow went from being the number one deck, bar none, in the era of Lurrus of the Dream Den, to being virtually non-existent. It was like you go weeks without seeing a Death Shadow player putting up a top result. But all of a sudden we had Modern Master and streamer Canister won a weekend Magic Online challenge with Grixis Death Shadow. And then just like that, it was all the rage. Everyone playing Death Shadow, one or two copies in every top 8. So this deck is back in a big way. And even though you have lost Lurrus, you can replace it with any combination of Street Wraith, Delve creatures, you know, Planeswalkers, Seasoned Pyromancer, whatever you like, and you still get to have all this efficient removal, all this efficient disruption, expressive iteration, Death Shadow, Dress Down, and that still makes for a really effective recipe. Number 4, Teemer Cascade. So yet another of these cascade into the particular Suspend card decks. This case, it's Crashing Footfalls. And the advantage of Teemer Cascade over something like Living End is that it's a really low lift, low effort combo. All you really have to do is put the Crashing Footfalls and the Cascade cards in your deck. And there are so many ways to circumvent the Cascade restriction in Modern right now. You think about the adventure creatures like Brazen Borrower, you think about the split cards like Fire and Ice, the forces, Force of Negation, Force of Vigor, the pitch elementals like Fury. And all of a sudden you have this deck that's basically just a really, really good Teemer color mid-range deck that happens to have the combo built in. All right, number 3, we're getting right up there at this point. Colossus Hammer. So another deck that suffered a little bit from the banning of Lurrus of the Dream Den, but Colossus Hammer was able to really effectively rebound. And this is what I was talking about when I referenced the sort of gold standard for Urza's Saga decks. Colossus Hammer has the perfect intersection of like fast and explosive with the combo draw where you equip Colossus Hammer really quickly, but also the staying power of Urza's Saga and Stoneforge Mystic, great sideboard options in Sanctifier Envec and Blacksmith Skill. So another really good, really well-rounded deck that rewards the skill of its pilot and is something that, you know, if you're looking for a deck to pick up in Modern, I do recommend Colossus Hammer as a way to invest your time. Number two is Omnath Midrange. So we already talked about Elementals, and of course Omnath Midrange is going to have a lot of the same strengths, but it does not play Risen Reef, and instead it just focuses on more of a individual card quality, well-rounded game plan. So you might see Counterspell, you might see Ice Fang Quaddle, but in general, the idea is you have four colors of mana, you have all the best cards in the format, you often have Yorion Sky Nomad as a companion. These decks are just very difficult to attack and very difficult to grind out or force them to ever run out of gas. All right, and the number one deck for this installment, you may have guessed it, is it Murktide? Really clean, really powerful, really efficient. Murktide Regent is just absurdly powerful as a creature that often represents two mana for a 7/7 or an 8/8. This deck was already good and I was already ranking it number one. Then it picked up Ledger Shredder as another really effective early flying creature and another really effective way to churn through its library, increase consistency, see those key answer cards when you need them more often. So yeah, I would say nothing can really touch Is It Murktide right now. If you disagree or if you think there's a deck I left off the rankings, I would love to hear some discussion in the comments. So feel free to let me know. And in the meantime, I will see you next time on the Video Power Rankings.